Hello everybody and welcome to video number 23 of the online version of the Fusion Research Lecture. We are in chapter 4, Particle Trajectories, and as you might remember in the last video we basically finished with discussing the trajectories in the tokamak field. We finished with talking about the bootstrap current, or by talking about the bootstrap current and the wear pinch. And today in this video we will have a look at the stellarator. So we will talk about particle trajectories in a stellarator field. Particle trajectories in a stellarator field. Now, as I already said a few lectures ago, important is the structure of the magnetic field on the flux surface. Yeah? So this is important to be aware of, the structure of the magnetic field on the flux surface is important. In the tokamak, the magnetic field was toroidally homogeneous, it was an axisymmetric device, and there was only a poloidal variation of the magnetic field. In the tokamak, the magnetic field B was toroidally, or is toroidally, homogeneous. It is an axisymmetric device, and there was only a poloidal variation of the magnetic field, where the strength scales with 1 over r, basically. In a stellarator now, however, everything is more complex. As you know, there is no general symmetry coordinate, no general symmetry coordinate. And as we will see, this means that particles can get lost due to drifts alone, something different as compared to a tokamak. It means particles can get lost due to drifts alone. Now let's first have a look at the structure of the of the magnetic field and the tokamak in comparison. So let's say we have a coordinate system which might look, for example, like this, where the horizontal coordinate is a direction along a magnetic field line. So here we're following a magnetic field line. And the vertical coordinate system is the absolute value of the magnetic field strength. Now, how does the magnetic field strength on a field line looks if we follow a tokamak? It has basically a sinusoidal shape. So let me now try to draw a sinusoidal shape. Might look, for example, well, roughly like this. So I guess you get it. So this is a tokamak having a sinusoidal shape, roughly. And now, as we discussed, particles can get trapped in this magnetic, well, this isn't a magnetic mirror, basically, where we can have trapped particles. These were the banana particles we discussed. Now, in a stellarator, there's an additional harmonic of the magnetic field strength. So, we also have the toroidal variation, but in addition, as I said, there's an additional harmonic of overlay to it, superpositioned, which might look, for example, like this. So this corresponds to the stellarator magnetic field strength along a magnetic field line, the stellarator, and we can get additional trapping in between these magnetic wells, basically. So we have an additional classification in addition a class of particles which can get trapped here in these small, we call this ripple in this small ripple here, as we will see. Okay, as an example, here is shown the magnetic field strength of a stellarator. So shown is here, this is an example, this is the magnetic field strength, magnetic field, or rather these are magnetic field contours of a torsatron, and to be more precise, of the TJK stellarator, the TJK torsatron, which is located at the University of Stuttgart in the lab. And the coordinate systems are such that the vertical coordinate system is the poloidal angle, and the horizontal coordinate here is the poloidal angle, and the vertical coordinate corresponds to the toroidal angle. So it's again unfolding a toroidal experiment, if you want. And as you might see, there is a certain symmetry, and in the toroidal direction we have a symmetry of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 here, and in this direction a symmetry of 1. So the the mode numbers of this stellarator are L equals 1 and M equals 6. And the color code in this plot works such that brighter colors are stronger magnetic field strength. So these areas have a higher magnetic field strength than this area here, for example. And the magnetic field strength is higher when the flux surfaces are closer to the coils. So in general, magnetic field strength is larger near the coils. And you know that the coils turn around helically, and the helical turn of the field maximum, which you can see here in this plot, basically reflects the coil structure. It reflects the coil structure. And the coil in this experiment winds around 6 times the torus helically. And thus here you can see a six-fold symmetry. Now, I said that, or I introduced this magnetic field contour plot, because we will use it as an example to look at how the orbits in a stellarator look like. So we will classify the orbits into different particles, into different categories. So the classification of orbits. So first of all, we of course also have passing particles. So we also have passing particles. Assuming, or if the parallel velocity is large enough. And passing particles in the plot on the right hand side might look, for example, if we follow one magnetic field line, then this passing particles, it might look, for example, something like, well, maybe something like this and like this. So this one corresponds to the magnetic field line. Well, let's maybe use, so this corresponds to a magnetic field line for the case of a value of iota bar equal to 1/3. And thus it roughly also corresponds to a passing particle, assuming that the particle stays on average on the magnetic field line. on the flux surface. As you know, this is not the case. It locally deviates from it, but still on average it stays on the flux surface. And this blue line here corresponds to a magnetic field line or to a passing particle. Yeah? So okay, what else? Now we can have trapped particles. Oops, what was that? We can have also, of course, trapped particles. And we can have these particles being trapped between proximate neighboring helical maxima. Trapped particles between proximate, which is just the same as neighboring, helical maxima. Oops, this should be an A, sorry, maxima. And in the plot on the right hand side, this would correspond, since again, brighter or lighter colors means higher magnetic field strength. So trapping between helical maxima would correspond, for example, to a particle which travels around like this and is trapped in this area there. And these particles are called helically trapped particles. These particles are called helically trapped particles, which are very important, as we will see. These are helically trapped particles corresponding to this one here. Now a few words on helically trapped particles. So helically trapped particles, just to indicate that we are talking about helically trapped particles. Now those particles are restricted in their movement, or are rather confined to only one side of the torus, being at the top or the bottom, where they are bouncing between the helical maxima. So helically trapped particles are restricted due to being trapped there or confined to one side of the torus, for example, top or bottom, top or bottom. And this has some important consequences, because in contrast to passing particles, which are moving around the whole torus, in contrast to passing particles, the trapped particles, their vertical drift due to the gradient drift or the diamagnetic drift, however you want to derive it, this is not compensated, which is usually achieved by the twist of the magnetic field. So the vertical drift, which is, for example, due to the grad B drift, cannot be compensated or does not cancel out. And this means that the particles can escape the confinement region. They can get lost. Particles can escape the confinement region. And the lost time can be estimated from the drifts. So the lost time can be estimated from first, well, let's indicate this is an estimation from the minor radius, and then the vertical drift velocity, which reads then Q A R B over M V squared, where V D is the vertical drift velocity, as you might have guessed. And for a stellarator with an electron temperature of 5 kiloelectron volt, this means we have a loss time of a few hundred microseconds, so a very short loss time. So this means that a conventional stellarator has poor performance. Yeah? So the stellarator performed very bad in the 1960s because it was not initially clear that these helically trapped particles lead to additional losses or that they are there. So there's a poor stellarator performance in the 1960s. And this is why the interest shifted to tokamaks at that time. Also, as you remember, I told you about the breakthrough experiments of the Soviet Union physicists of the T3 tokamak, where they achieved the record temperature of electrons and ions. And as I said, this is why there was only marginal interest in stellarators. Only very few countries kept working in stellarators, Germany and Japan basically being those two countries. Now, there is an additional orbit, type of orbits, and these are particles, particle orbits with a full toroidal turn between the reflections, the full toroidal turn between the reflections. So this would correspond to particles, for example, let's say if we start here and then it goes around like this, and then so it would be reflected here and then going further down to here and then being reflected here. So these particles have some characteristics or features of banana particles. So these particles have some characteristics of, or these orbits have characteristics of banana orbits from the tokamak, but their reflection will happen at different positions due to the lack of axis symmetry, which we do not have here in the stellarator. Happened at different positions because, as you might remember also from the banana particles, there's a toroidal recession, or sorry, a precession. And in a stellarator, without the lack of where we do not have an axis symmetric device, this leads to reflections at slightly different positions. Okay, and then there's another class of orbits. So D, because helically trapped particles can be trapped also in the toroidal ripple, not only in the poloidal one. So helically trapped particles can be trapped also in the toroidal ripple via the poloidal drift component. Yeah, the poloidal drift component. And these particles are called, these orbits are called super banana orbits, Because these are basically very fat bananas, so with a very large banana width, and this is why they are called super banana orbits. And if we were to draw these particles, then this might, for example, be a particle which bounces around like this. So following here the magnetic field strength like this, and then it goes continues here. So it also travels around toroidally, as you can see, much more than just a helically trapped particle would do. Now, as I said, these particles are called super banana particles, or they have super banana orbits due to their shape. And what happens is basically they have a very long duration of stay in regions of the at the reflection points. And you know from banana particles that the longer they stay there, the thicker the banana, so the larger the banana width becomes. Because this results in a large radial displacement of the particle as compared to the flux surface where the particle originally started. So a large radial displacement. And this leads to enlarged banana radii, enlarged banana radiuses. And this is why they are sometimes, in very few publications, you also find the expression fat bananas for that. Fat banana orbits, fat bananas. Okay, let's now have a look at an example. So I have a video for that. Oops, you can probably not really see that. So I have a video for that. So this video shows, first of all, color-coded the magnetic field strength in the Vega stellarator, and you can see a particle which has started somewhere. You can also see the gyro motion in this video of the particle. You can see the particle, let's start at the very end, how the particle is first reflected, then going around toroidally. So this is a particle which is following a longitudinal path, then it gets trapped between the helical maxima, and then it's lost immediately. Yeah, so this is a particle which is first trapped in a large toroidal ripple and then transits into a helical ripple and being immediately lost there. This is the same graphic again. This is from the Vega Stellarator, which was operated for quite a while at the IPP Greifswald. And what you have seen in this video was the transition from a toroidally trapped particle from a toroidally trapped particle to a helically trapped particle and the resulting immediate loss of that. And you could see that the particle gets lost. So the simulation basically stopped where the particle get lost, and being lost was defined here as hitting the vessel wall. Okay, I have another example, another video. Nope, not this one. Where is it here? Okay, so again, color-coded magnetic field strength. Then we have three particles all starting at the exact same position, but with a different pitch angle, meaning the ratio between the parallel and the perpendicular velocity varies. And here you can see these three particles. The red one immediately transits or goes into a helically trapped particle and then is lost. The blue one is a passing particle, and the yellow one is moving in the other direction against the magnetic field, and you can see how this is trapped. So this has a similar shape if you would look at the poloidal projection, like a banana particle in a tokamak. Okay, so what you have seen there was a video, a simulation from an L equals 2, M equals 5 stellarator. And these were three particles which started at the same position but with different pitch angles, Okay. That's it for this video. We have talked about particle trajectories in a stellarator field. We have hopefully learned that in addition to a tokamak where we only have the toroidal ripple resulting in trapped particles, in the stellarator we also have a helical ripple which results in a number of few possible orbits, possible trapped particles. We have looked at these different type of particles, classified them, and have seen that helically trapped particles can lead to very fast losses in a stellarator, which leads to very poor performance in normal and classical stellarators or torsatrons, as it was the case in the 1960s. And in the next videos we will see how to compensate for that and why modern stellarators reach similar confinement times as modern tokamaks. Okay, that's it. Hope to see you in the next video.